Driscoll here tonight to talk about it. And prior to that, Tom Brody, who's also of the Valley Poverty Program, wanted to do a little, he was inspired by Adrian's presentation of the prospect of it, and he wants to do a monologue that is served as an intro to Adrian. And the other thing I want to say, we're starting very promptly, and one reason is because our bathroom is out of order. We've been coming up tomorrow morning at 11, but that doesn't even help anybody tonight. It is possible to make small donations to the department if absolutely necessary. Otherwise, I think we have to really kind of fix here so you can tell us. Okay, here's our
DTLA 2040 is the name given by the Department of City Planning to the process of updating the downtown community plan with new zoning policies. Last year, City Planning hosted DTLA 2040 Open House, a series of public workshops that were right over here in the Bradbury Building. The Open House went from October 3rd to October 8th. That was 2016. The Downtown Center Business Improvement District played a major role in these 5 days of community input. The team leader for the downtown community plan process is Brian Eck. The Bradbury Building is in the historic core. The mission of the Historic Core Business Improvement District. The Historic Core Business Improvement District works to improve the quality of life of residents, property, and business owners in the historic core through clean, safe enterprise and community benefit programs. A few weeks after these 5 days of DTLA 2040 public meetings in the Bradbury Building, Brian Eck received the following letter from the Historic Core Business Improvement District. November 10th, 2016, Mr. Brian Eck, City Planner, Department of City Planning, Los Angeles City Council, 200 North Spring Street, room 667, Los Angeles, California, 90012, regarding downtown community plan recommendations. Dear Mr. Eck, the Historic Core Business Improvement District Executive Committee was given the task by the Historic Core Business Improvement Board of Directors to write a list of recommendations for the new zoning of downtown Los Angeles. The following is the list of recommendations. Recommendation number one, considering the shortage of housing in the city of Los Angeles and the considerable expense of building affordable housing through nonprofits, the committee recommends creating incentives for market housing developments to include affordable and workforce units within their projects. Greater incentives should be given for mixed income projects within the 50 blocks that encompass the boundaries of Skid Row. These incentives could be property tax abatement for the life of the project or 55 years and or TFAR bonuses. Note, the term Skid Row is as defined here by the Department of Public Health, which is likely a broader area than what has been historically defined as Skid Row. Recommendation number two, areas such as Arts District, Skid Row as defined above, and Fashion District should be considered beneficial locations for mixed income, mixed use projects by not restricting zoning nor implementing height limits. Recommendation number three, the necessity of the preservation of a nonprofit zone could be alleviated by simply offering floor area ratio bonuses to developers willing to lease to nonprofits or service providers in retail spaces in the designated area. Incorporating the population served by nonprofits into the rest of the community will ultimately serve them better and alleviate a zone traditionally more impacted by crime and public health issues. Incentives could also reward current lessors by rewarding their efforts rather than excluding diverse retail development in the area. And recommendation number four, Areas should be expanded wherever reasonable, but especially in the areas of Skid Row and the Fashion District, which are in need of more housing. Recommendation number 5, the implementation of an artist-in-residence model of housing for fashion designers for live-work housing called Fashion-in-Residence would be an excellent manner in which to encourage and growth of fashion manufacturing and business in the Fashion District. Recommendation number 6, Los Feliz. There are many encouraging signs in Los Feliz, yet also untapped potential. We hope to see reflected in your plan. We do have a very specific recommendation, which we are confident will benefit both the business and residential population of Los Feliz, which is to highlight the holiday shopping season by requiring Los Feliz during the month of December to be known as Los Feliz Navidad. Recommendation number seven, Chicago. Obviously one of America's great cities, and we trust DTLA 2040 is giving the greatness of this city due diligence. We are concerned that certain matters are trending downward that will negatively impact the business community of Chicago both in the short and the long term. We will submit a more detailed set of recommendations in the near future, as including Chicago in this particular letter just occurred to us recently as we were watching the Dodgers play the Chicago Cubs. There's actually 27 recommendations here, so I'm going to go through a couple of them real fast. Recommendation number 8 has to do with restaurants in Hong Kong. Recommendation number 9 just says Tulsa, so I guess there's more information at some point. And recommendation number 10 is about one specific vacant lot in Jackson, Mississippi. I'll just go to the end. Respectfully submitted, Blair Beston, Executive Director, Historic Core Business Improvement District.
Wow. What date is that?
November 10th, 2016.
That was your introduction, I guess. Sorry. Okay, yes. Awesome.
Hello, I'm Adrian Riskin. Thank you all for coming. I'd like to extend a special welcome to my friends from the Hollywood Property Owners Alliance, Carrie Morrison, who's the executive director, Devin, last name I forgot, is the director of communications, and Joe Marion, who's, I can't remember what. Anyway, thanks for making the long trip downtown. So the first thing I want to say is I have a PDF that was too long to print, but if you want to download it to your phone, I put it here. If you go there, there'll be a download link for a PDF. There's going to be some complicated emails later on. Maybe it'll be nice to have in your hand. Cool. Okay. I'm going to talk about the influence of business improvement districts on the Skid Row Neighborhood Council election that just took place in April. But before I do, I thought I would talk a little bit about what business improvement districts are, because I've been studying them for the last 2.5 years, and most people don't understand what they are at all. I think it's only in the last few months that I've felt like I had a really good grasp on what's going on. So here's the idea. A business improvement district is some land in the city. I'm just talking about Los Angeles. They have these all over the state, but I'm going to keep saying Los Angeles. So a business improvement district is some land in the city of Los Angeles, and it has commercial property on it, and the properties in the district pay extra property taxes to the city in order to fund various kinds of activities that I'll be talking about more in a minute. So it's important to notice, if you're talking to big people, don't ever say property taxes, they call them assessments. Super important distinction for certain reasons. in any case, the business improvement district is the property itself. It's the land, like the historic core district, it's some blocks over there. The people that you talk to, who are also usually called the bid, they're actually not part of the bid, they're part of what's called the property owners association. Those are the people that get the money from the taxes and then spend it on stuff. They usually, a POA is usually a private nonprofit corporation. It's always a private nonprofit corporation, sometimes formed by the city to run the bid specifically. Sometimes it's a nonprofit corporation that just happened to already exist and they gave them a bid. Like in Hollywood, we have the Hollywood Chamber of Commerce and they run the East Hollywood bid. But the bid that Carrie runs, or the two bids, the Hollywood Property Owners Alliance was formed on purpose to run those bids. I know I'm glossing over in detail, but I hope you're not coming. Okay, I'm a teacher, and one of my tips is that I ask, are there any questions, like, all the time. So I'm going to ask, are there any questions? Please, I'm not kidding. That's awesome. Yes?
So, do you know the nonprofit that was created or existed when the bids downtown were put into motion by the CRA back in the mid-80s?
No, you know, I know nothing about the bids. Everything I know started in 1994. I'll talk about that later, so I have no idea. Yes, sorry.
Well, you're a member of the bids, or you work for the bids?
No, I don't work for the bids.
Was it the other one you mentioned?
Yeah, in Hollywood?
No.
Historic Court?
Yeah, Historic Court.
Uh-huh. No, I don't work for them.
Question answered.
Okay. Are there other questions? Okay, so the modern form of business improvement districts in California began in 1994 with the passage of a law that authorized them. And in that law, there's an explanation of what bids were meant to do. I guess what the legislature had in mind when they authorized the creation of bids. If you're following along in the PDF, this is the section on what do bids do in theory.
Excuse me.
So I don't like to read laws out loud because they're possible to understand, but let me just read one sentence or two from the beginning of the bid law. The legislature told us that businesses located and operating within business districts in some of this state's communities are economically disadvantaged, are underutilized, and are unable to attract customers due to inadequate facilities, services, and activities in the business districts. So the law, it goes on to say that the idea is it's in the public interest to let business owners tax themselves extra in order to get extra money to spend on stuff to kind of mitigate those conditions of blight and inadequate facilities and so on. So this is the theory of bids. The commercial property owners in a district pay extra money that's going to be spent in that district to mitigate blight and underutilization and so on. Other questions on that?
Can you repeat that again?
Yeah. Do you want me to read it again or repeat it?
No, just repeat that last about mitigating and what.
Okay. The theory is, I'm going to repeat the idea. But
okay.
The theory is that in a bid, property owners tax themselves extra money that they then spend in their district in order to mitigate blighted conditions or underutilization or inadequate facilities and services. So that's the theory. Thinking of downtown, if you think of bids downtown, it's conceivable that that applies in Skid Row, I don't know, with the downtown industrial district, but if you think of like the historic core, the downtown center bid, which is over by 6th and Wilshire, there's a little bit of disconnect there between maybe what the legislature intended and what we actually see, which is not so much blighted areas, but unblighted areas. Yes.
So the bids are just property owners, not the towns themselves.
Yes, okay. There's a subtlety that I was glossing over. There's two kinds of bids in California that have to do with businesses. One is a property owner bid, one is a business owner bid. So most of the bids, like probably 40 out of 45-ish bids in Los Angeles are property owner bids. Those are just the property owners, not the business owners at all. There are a few bids in Los Angeles, like Los Feliz, Little Tokyo, I think, some few others that are property owner, I'm sorry, business owner groups. And it's a really interesting question for a number of reasons that I have time to
Is it kind of like, could you say it's a little bit comparable to like an HOA? Except they have their own security wing or something like that.
You know, I don't know enough about HOAs to know. I'm sorry.
Like a homeowner's association?
Yeah, no, I know what it is, but I don't know what they do, so I can't compare.
Yes, I think the DCA is business. I'm pretty sure I've researched that.
Yeah.
The DCA is a business. It's all businesses.
I would be surprised. Does anybody know?
Carrie, you know certain about that.
You guys know?
I think it's property.
It's property.
I believe it's property. That's all right. We don't have to argue. It doesn't matter. There's just both kinds in the city.
So,
yes.
We got to turn on downtown here, so I want to know what all this has to do with what's going to happen downtown, about the housing, all that whole stuff.
Okay, I hope to get to that. Right.
Okay, well, I don't have a question.
Well, that's okay. I'm just. As a teacher, I always come to students. No, the only stupid question is the one you don't ask, so please ask away. Okay, are there others? Okay, yes.
I'm surprised by what you just said. If, let's say, it's 40 out of 45 relate to property owners, but yet isn't the standard title for any, I mean, just the name bid is business improvement. So right off the bat, it's like, it's not correct language.
Okay. Well, that's partly my fault, okay? I'm shortening things because in the law, they refer to property bids and merchant bids, okay? Which I think is reasonable because property, owning commercial property is a kind of business. And then when we all just say bid, it's because we're not involved in the weird technical distinctions in the law. You'll see, especially in some of the older materials that I look at, you see property bids, they call them P-bids instead of just bids. To make the distinction. Yes.
When Ben speaks of blighted or unblighted area, like you're talking about Skid Row, they're talking about objective situation, how things are, but they're not talking about the people. Do they want to get rid of Skid Row and blighted area and the homeless people there?
Okay. I mean, my opinion is that they do, but I don't know. I can't say definitively, but I think so. I see this a lot with bids. You know, they're property bids. They focus on the value of the commercial property in their district, and very little else matters to them. So I don't see how the people
can match the budget. I saw the proposal for development at downtown LA City Council page. It's on their website. It's like 120 pages. It's worth a PDF. They talked about developing parks, and which is okay. I mean, we all like parks and things. But they never mentioned Skid Row in any of those 120 pages. I thought that was really interesting.
Yeah, it's not so surprising, but it is upsetting. Are there other questions? Okay, so let me also talk about now how the city of Los Angeles relates to its business improvement districts. That is, the city is fundamentally involved at every stage of a business improvement district lifecycle. And until very recently, I didn't know much about bids in other cities in California, but just in the last few weeks, I've had some experience with bids in Santa Monica and in San Francisco, and it's led me to suspect that the city of Los Angeles is completely unique in the state of California and how it treats the bids. I don't know for sure. That's my theory, my working theory right now. Maybe next year I can come back and tell you what's going on comparatively. But anyway, I want to talk about the city of Los Angeles and how it relates to business improvement districts, because it's super important to understand the influence that bids have with city politics. First of all, when a bid is going to be formed, when they're going to start a brand new bid, it is, I think, this part's a little harder to get evidence on, but I think it's often, if not mostly, the idea of the council district involved. That is, it's possible that one or two property owners want to start a bid, or it's possible that just the city council district itself wants to start a bid, or it's possible that some organization like the Chamber of Commerce wants to start a bid. I know in Hollywood, the Chamber of Commerce is involved right now in starting a couple of bids. I don't know how ordinary that is, but once a bid, once the process for forming a bid gets moving, the city's involved at every stage. They have a fund where they pay consultants to help bids get formed. They'll pay up to $40,000 to a consultant to help a bid get started. Ideally, I think maybe technically, the property owners are supposed to match that $40,000, but I know that at least in some cases, the city council district will pay for some of the matching funds out of their discretionary money. I don't know how often that happens, but it does happen. The city puts an immense amount of staff time into forming bids. Bids are administered through the city clerk's office, and in the process of forming a bid, city clerk employees work with the bid consultant, getting all the material ready that the law requires, and it seems to take, I think, hundreds of hours over 12 to 18 months before the bid can get started. That's another investment that the city makes in starting a bid. The most important part, though, is that city-owned property is allowed to be in a bid and to pay assessments. Bids love to have city-owned property in them because it's like this guaranteed income stream, and the city always votes in favor of having a bid. In fact, they're required to always vote in favor of having a bid unless, and you can imagine if you know how our city council works, unless the city council specifically says, no, we won't vote in favor. That is, the default is for city property to vote in favor of having a bid. So some bids have very little city property, but you guys have negligible, yes? Not much, right? Not at Venice. This has lately gone to some extremes that are quite amazing. In Venice Beach, a bid started this year, which is over 25% city property. If you look at the shape of it, you can see how all that city property ended up being included. In San Pedro, there's a bid that isn't newly formed this year, but it's newly expanded this year to include tons of Port of LA property, which, as far as I can see, the point is just to jack up the money that they collect by getting city property involved. There's no business going on that Port of LA property. And so that's like the third main way that the city of Los Angeles promotes bids kind of before they get formed. Other questions? Yes?
If the city's so involved in setting the bids up, what's the rationale for splitting them off the nonprofits when I just have the city?
The state law requires that. The state bid law mandates that there be a nonprofit that wants to bid. Yes?
Who basically invented the bid? Is there a first bid that you can trace?
No, I haven't spent any time on that. I will say
Toronto.
Toronto?
Toronto, late 70s.
That's the first modern bid.
Yes,
in,
okay. Toronto, late 70s.
Mid-70s, okay. If you read bid propaganda, it's got that kind of history like you see on Wikipedia. Business owners assessing themselves for special projects goes back to the Roman Empire. I read that on a bid website. It's the kind of thing where you only have to look it up to know it's made up. So Toronto is the first. Are there other questions on this?
What's a typical lifespan? Like, are they created and they just stick around forever? Or?
Okay, in practice, I think that's true, but not under the law. The way it works is that this is, what I'm saying is only for property-based bids. merchant-based bids have to renew every year. They're only good for a year. Property-based bids can be the first time, when they're first created, they can be for up to 5 years. Sometimes, I don't know how they decide, sometimes they're for fewer than 5 years, but the maximum lifespan of a first-time bid is 5 years. When they renew, they have to renew after 5 years, and they can renew for up to 10 years if they're renewing, but I don't know how they choose to renew for fewer than 10 years. But 10 years, as far as I know, please correct me if I'm wrong, is the maximum that a bid can renew for. And then they would have to go through the process every 10 years. Are there other questions? Okay. during the formation of a bid, after the preliminaries are all set up and all the research has been done and all these reports and required databases and stuff have been set up and submitted to the clerk, the whole mess goes to the city council. So the state law is actually, it gives tons of power to the city council. Under the state law, when the city council gets all this stuff, this plan for the new bid, they're allowed to just rewrite the whole thing right there on the floor of the city council if they want to. They can. The new bid has to submit reports saying what they're going to do with the money. You know, they're going to hire security guards, they're going to clean the street, whatever. They have to say it all in advance. And then the city council can just change it. They can say, no, you're not cleaning the street. Instead, you're going to paint all the buildings green. That's an extreme example, but they do have the power to rewrite everything. Not only that, they can remove properties from the bid before they approve it. They can lower assessments on the properties if they want to. The one thing they're forbidden from doing is raising the assessments, and I think that has to do with taxation laws in the state of California. The city council is not allowed to just randomly raise people's taxes, although they are allowed to lower them. Those are powers that the state law gives the city council when a bid is being formed. Informally, they have other powers that I think rely on the bizarre nature of Los Angeles city politics, where each councilman is like a dictator in his own district. I've seen examples where multiple groups of property owners, this happened in the arts district, wanted to form a bid and the city councilman for the district just chose one. It made some of the others quite mad. The city councilman there told the successful group of property owners that they had to accept four of the unsuccessful ones onto their board. This is the kind of power that was supposed to be bizarre in 2013. They can, I guess that's all I want to say about that. Okay, and then after a bid is formed, every single year the bid has to go back to city council and submit what's called an annual planning report, which lays out what they're going to spend their money on, and that has to be approved by the city council. And again, the city council has the power to change it. So the bid can say, well, we want to spend our money on X, Y, and Z. The city council can say X and Y are fine, but also think about W. This doesn't usually happen in the actual city council, but there are cases where the city clerk has told bids. She gets the annual planning report. They say they're going to do this stuff. The staff of the city clerk will say, no, we don't want you to do that. Change the words in your report. So the city has an immense amount of control over how bids spend their money through that process of requiring revisions of the plan. Questions? Yes?
Do you have a sense of where those changes are coming from in the city? Who is suggesting them and how they're filtering down?
It's Miranda Pastor who suggests them. Holly Wolcott is the clerk, and as far as I can see, this is my speculation. Okay, there's not much like direct evidence of what's going on in that book, but my feeling is that Miranda Pastor, who's been working on bids for decades and is quite an expert in what they should and shouldn't do and what they can and can't do, is mostly in charge. Like the emails and the directives to change things in the planning report have come from. And I've seen her staff say to bids, like, I got to check with upper management about things. So I'm pretty sure she's the one. Ultimately, I mean, that's how the city works. Ultimately, you know, she approves it. Holly Wolcott sends it to the council with a recommendation to pass it. So I think, you know, she's the prime mover, but it's the city council ultimately that has the authority. Are there other questions? Yes.
Yeah, are those positions appointed by the mayor, or are those elected? How those positions of Miranda and Holly?
No, Holly, in Los Angeles, the clerk is not elected. I don't know.
So it's appointed by the mayor?
I assume that it's appointed by the mayor or the city council. I don't know how the clerk is chosen. I think there are cities in the state of California which do have elected clerks, but we're not one of them. Miranda Pastor is staff, so I assume she's just hired through the normal city hiring processes, although I don't know for sure.
But staff for 35 years, that sounds like it's pretty ingrained.
I don't know 35 years. You guys know when Miranda started working there? It's probably not more than 20, because kids have only been around since 1994 in their modern home. I don't know. Yeah, there's very little democratic control over bids in Los Angeles.
Okay, are there other questions? Oh, sorry, yes.
I want to address these questions to these people that just got there to talk. Any one of y'all employed by the business improvement district?
No.
Nobody?
I am.
Okay. With you, that may not be curb my enthusiasm anyway. What about the other one? What's an H? What's that?
Historic Court.
Historic Court.
Okay, so we're getting closer to just the row. I talked before about what bids do in theory. They mitigate blighted conditions, extra property taxes. Now I want to talk a little bit about what bids in Los Angeles do in practice. Number one, if you look at all the bids websites, and the city clerk's website on bids, it will be very easy to believe that all the business improvement districts do is trim the trees in their neighborhood. They love this example. They always say that, we decided to tax ourselves extra money so that our trees could get trimmed because the city can't afford to do it. Okay, so it is true that every bid that I know of in the city of Los Angeles provides street cleaning services and tree trimming if there's trees around there. That is like the one universal activity.
That's a bit silly.
What?
Trimming trees?
Well, you know, they trim trees in their neighborhood. Like, you guys trim 400 trees in your
trimming tips. So,
I don't know.
But they contract it out, probably, right?
Well, sure, but they're spending the money that they get. I mean, it doesn't matter who's actually doing that.
Right. I mean, property tax is paid to the county of Los Angeles, right?
Right.
Now, what is the economic financial relationship of the city of Los Angeles and private business or property owners? I mean, there's some economics or finance that comes into it. Money comes into it.
Right. Well, here's how it works.
Yeah.
The business owners, the property owners pay with their property taxes, they pay it to the county. They pay it to the county.
Yeah.
With their property tax.
Right.
But the county gives it back to the city.
They give it back to the city?
Yes. And the city takes a service fee, like maybe 6%, and then gives the rest of it to the debt. So that's how that works. Okay. So the other major activity that bids are involved in is security guards. Not every bid in the city of Los Angeles has security guards, but most of them do. Of course, if you live downtown, you're super familiar with bid security guards because they're everywhere. Everywhere in their bids.
Somebody ran them over for them. I'm out there on Central. That's why my name is.
So the range of bid security in the city is astounding. It's like I said, some bids don't have security. Like Larchmont Village, no security. Brentwood Village does not have security. I can't think of others that don't, but I know there are some. Then most bids have like a fairly light level of security. Like in North Hollywood, they ride their bikes around the subway station there, and if you're sitting on the sidewalk too long, and you don't look palatable, they might tell you to move, but they're not aggressive as far as I can tell. Up to the various bids downtown, which have like a whole spectrum of aggressiveness. Sorry to say with you guys here, but the two Hollywood bids that Carrie's involved with are the absolute most aggressive security guards in the entire city. They are the only security guards that wear guns that I know of. I think they're the only ones that make custodial arrests of people, sometimes over 1,000 a year.
Are bid security allowed to legally be on public property?
Absolutely.
And are they allowed to enforce themselves on public property?
Yes, this is the state laws of California. Anybody can actually.
What do you mean anybody can?
You can go out there and arrest somebody right now if you saw them submitting on
the like a citizen's arrest.
That's what they do, citizen's arrest. Yes. But it turns out, and I don't know the details legally, but it turns out factually that if you have some handcuffs, you can probably handcuff those people too. Please, this is not legal.
No, but I mean, if they're handcuffing you, then where's your right? You're, you know what I'm saying? And they're handcuffing you and they're holding you until the police come.
That's right.
They have that right here downtown.
Do they do that?
Yes.
I guess you could arrest them too.
The bids don't have
I mean, it's crazy trying to arrest somebody that called the police on you. I mean, it's stupid. It's just... I don't know, but it happens here regularly.
Yes.
So, the Hollywood Bates still have guns?
Yes, they still have guns.
Because, like, it is my understanding that the bids used to have guns, and, like, originally that was what they would do, is ride around with their guns. But it was found that because they're not police officers, they couldn't walk around with guns.
Okay, so yeah,
that was only here for Skid Row. It didn't cover.
But that should be like universal. Then.
Yeah, but
if you're not a police officer, you can't. Like,
yeah, it was only based. They only fought that lawsuit for that particular bid in Skid Row. Yeah, that was that one particular one. That's why they can't carry it.
I hear so much. Some people, you know, even on radio, talking about Skid Row. The urine and feces on there. I'm there almost every day. I hardly notice that, you know? And what is the direct relationship between bids and the LAPD or any law enforcement? There must be a direct relationship because bid security guards work together with the police department, right?
Yes, they do. This is like one of the things I've been working on understanding for years. It's incredibly difficult to understand. I have no answers for you because everybody involved is
key. Yeah, but the history of this country is criminalizing black people or brown people, you know? And all this police action seems to keep perpetuating that.
Yeah, there's no question. I think that that's true. Okay.
I would recommend a website. There's a law firm in the South, I think in Alabama. It's called S, as in Sam, P. LCenter.org stands for Southern Poverty Law Center.org, and they're always putting law firms against neo-Nazis, KKK, racist groups, white supremacist racist group against minorities, even Jews nowadays in this bad economic climate. You know, so all of this, I recommend that people go into that website because they have huge backing by American public. They win a lot of lawsuits against this kind of abuse by these racist groups.
Okay, so the last thing I want to talk about that bids do in practice that seems to me to have the least justification in the law, but like I said, I'm not a lawyer, and that is that bids in Los Angeles lobby the city of Los Angeles incessantly. Okay, they spend time, they spend money, they generate personal relationships with politicians in order to be able to suggest laws, in order to be able to change, get laws changed how they like. They lobby in all kinds of different ways. They'll have their board of directors authorize the staff to write a letter to a councilman saying, hey, our bid supports law X, or we hate law Y, like that. This is a normal thing that nonprofits do, of course. They meet regularly with council staff or council, actual council representatives, like in Hollywood. Terry's bid meets once a month with Metro Farrell's staff at for breakfast to talk about their needs. And for all I know, they mean more than that. They get groups of people together from their board of directors and from their staff to go to city meetings and make coordinated comments. So if you're at a meeting where they're discussing something that bids are interested in, sometimes you'll see like 8 people from a bid all making comments that they probably all wrote together in order to kind of create a show of support somehow. Bids will coordinate among themselves to lobby effectively. This happened starting in 2015 with the street vending legalization thing that Del Cidio and somebody else proposed. There was a mass amount of coordinated lobbying by bids all over the city to get that change. And they were successful in getting a change. I know in the LA Times you read that the city council decriminalized street vending, which was a huge thing. There's no question that that's positive. But at the same time, they changed the law from, they changed the proposed law from allowing street vending across the entire city of Los Angeles to what the current proposal is, which is to allow council members to opt districts out for no reason whatsoever, which is quite criminal. I think that was a bid generated change. Okay, are there questions on what bids do then? Yes.
Oh, well, I don't know what bids do. I'm going to go back a little bit. I just want to understand them. Did you say that state law says a nonprofit has to run these bids?
Yes.
So, is it one nonprofit that runs the bid, each bid?
Yes.
Or is it one, they run all?
Okay, so the way the law says there has to be a nonprofit that runs each bid. So
okay.
A nonprofit can run more than one bid, or they can just run one bid.
Like so can you name like a nonprofit that
yeah,
runs
there's
it?
The Hollywood Property Owners Alliance, Carrie's the executive director. That runs the Hollywood Entertainment District bid, and they also contract with the nonprofit that runs this other bid in Hollywood called the Central Hollywood Coalition, which now I think Joe, if he's still here, is the executive director of that. But it's still the Hollywood Property Owners Alliance is one that's running two.
And how do you find that out? How do you find out who runs your bid?
You look on their website. They sometimes explain it. You can ask them. You can send the director an email and ask for their bylaws.
Central City Association runs the DC bid downtown.
I think, okay, that's a little complicated maybe. I think they do run it, but they have the same staff, for instance. Like,
yes, they do.
I think it may be that there's a separate nonprofit, you know? I don't know. Yes.
So which bid initiated that street vendor change?
Okay. I think that was the Central City Association that coordinated all the bids in the city. That's my impression. The Central City Association has weekly or regular policy meetings that bid people attend so that they can set policy and decide how to lobby.
So can you say that the CCEA is the strongest, most powerful bid in the city of LA?
No,
yes.
Sorry, that's a common mistake that I made myself for a long time. The CCEA is different from the CCA. There's the Central City East Association is the nonprofit that runs the downtown industrial district. And the Central City Association is an old Los Angeles business group that also, if they don't run the downtown center bid directly, they run it more or less the same. Like Carol Schatz was the executive director of both. For a long time until she retired from one, now she's just the executive director of the bid, and somebody else runs this.
Right.
They go back to the 1920s, they were trying to clean up Main Street during Prohibition.
Yes.
So there are two different things here. One is basically these business owners are investing their money, putting up for taxes, so their neighborhood improves or their business. Which I don't really feel sorry much about because like they're part of the problem actually. Second thing, involved in politics of the city and deciding about certain things, meaning they're lobbying So they have some sort of power because they are having influence over the city officials that they chose. That's a problem. So basically, them throwing money on taxes and not being able to get that to return, I don't think we should feel sorry for them doing that. I mean, they're stupid. I mean, if they want to waste their money and do that kind of stuff, fine. They don't want to help homeless. I mean, they want to give money to the county, give 6% whatever else to the city and get something in return or not. But the worry is, like you said, I think we should make a point here in this story that you said, because I don't know if people here get it, is that there is inequality in these bids in different neighborhoods, and politics are different. And people who are having less money, or I mean a poor neighborhood, are getting oppressed by the more rich neighborhoods because they're making laws for the rest of us. So I think that's what the point is, right? So maybe we should stick to that and see how we can work that out legally, so we can stop these people from being connected in Chamber of Commerce and business improvement district. So basically they're sitting on several different chairs and just like doing whatever they want.
One of the most extreme examples I know of about that is right here in downtown, where the business seats on D-Link that are reserved for businesses are the vast majority of them are filled by bid staff members. So.
Thank you.
Right.
That's a popular feature. Should be legal, actually.
Yes, it should be illegal. It's collusion.
Yeah. So that's
how we're going to
get.
Okay.
It's
called collusion.
So,
how about
super
about
where is it when you need it? All right, let me just talk super quickly about the Public Records Act and why it is that business improvement districts are subject to it. The Public Records Act in California is a right in the Constitution of California that gives all citizens the right to look at the writings and the other records generated by government agencies. And of course, that includes the city of Los Angeles, but amazingly, it also includes business improvement districts. And the story of that, Kerry was actually intimately involved in this change in the law. Was it 96? I don't know. Okay. What happened in 1996 is in her bid in Hollywood, their meetings were closed even to property owners. They wouldn't let them in. And one of the property owners, Aaron Epstein, sued the bid for access to the meetings under the state's open meeting law, which is called the Brown Act. And he said that because the bids were created by the city of Los Angeles and they were funded through tax money, that they were subject to the Brown Act. And the Superior Court disagreed with him. He lost his case. And he appealed it to the state appellate court, who agreed with him. Made business improvement districts subject to the Brown Act, which in turn makes them subject to the Public Records Act. So this turns out to be an immensely powerful tool. If any of you have questions about bids that I haven't been able to answer in detail, I encourage you to go to the bids themselves and ask them for records. You have the absolute right to look at those records. After that all happened, the decision where it happened, the decision that the appellate court wrote, states super clearly that the assessments are tax money, and states super clearly that the private nonprofit organizations are actually created by the city of Los Angeles. They're arms of the city government. So bid people will tell you that's not true. Everybody tells me that's not true. They all tell me they're private. Probably Wolcott tells me that all the time. It's not true. They're branches of the city of Los Angeles, according to the state appellate court. And when it comes to these kind of things, that's the only thing. Okay, that is my introduction to bids, which is twice as long as I thought. So I hope it was not a waste of your time. Are there questions on anything to do with what bids are? And yes. I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
Well, I'm looking at this map. Black pins on the map. I was wondering if these are security outposts or what they are.
I'm sorry, I don't know anything about that map.
I have no idea.
The map.
So this playable miniature golf course is about zoning in Los Angeles, in particular about the new zoning as it might affect Skid Row as it's taken. It's in process right now. You can come back and play it Friday, Saturday, and Thursday afternoons, and you can read all about it at the different halls.
But he was asking specifically.
Yeah, I know. I can't get into it right now because it's not really going to be.
Yes.
Given the widespread use of bids, not only in the United States but elsewhere, have you seen examples of the ways that different localities have been able to push back against the power wielded by them, either legally or through promotional or other kinds of grassroots activism? And I admit that I'm saying this in the context of community plan and the ways in which some ways to counter the power of the bids in that planning process might be affected as downtown is engaging the community planning process, and also Hollywood finalizes what's happening there.
Yeah, okay. Like I said, it's taken me close to 2 years to understand bids just in Los Angeles. I don't know anything about bids elsewhere. And I don't know much about organizing success against them, except what you were talking about. Pete White told me about the same thing, where somehow LA CAN got the downtown industrial district security to stop carrying guns, which I think is a major victory. But I don't, maybe you know how it happened.
Well, it was just a grassroots campaign. We bombarded them. We camped outside their headquarters. We camped outside Shot's place. We sent emails out. We marched. We petitioned. We came to City Hall. We disrupted City Hall. We did all the things that you would do to make effective change. Well, that's what we did.
Already, you want to take a minute and tell them about the latest one we just got off what we're going to do with it. Let them know.
One of our most recent victories against the bid was getting them to stop taking people's property, because originally the police department was taking people's property, and then their next tactic after the courts ruled that no city employee could take a homeless person's property, they started using the bids to do it, and so the courts found that the bids, since they do get tax money and they are publicly funded in some way, that they are also could not take homeless people's property. That's the most recent.
That's that
recent.
What
happened as a result of that? What did we get as a reward? Don't we be the one who
controlled?
Yep. They got to do it our way from downtown Skid Row, say what it's ready for.
Are there any questions?
Can I just rephrase it? I'm sorry. Have you seen other examples of resistance to this collusive power that we've been identifying? Just, you know, really based on the research you've done on Los Angeles.
Yeah, not much, except for LA CAN. That seems to be the only organization that resisted and was successfully cutting them off.
And then I had that campaign started in 2006.
Oh, 2006.
Yes. Well, on your website, it's actually kind of what inspired me to even like go in the direction I went in, is you're suggesting that such like a blatant package of recommendations that clearly go beyond their mission statement, clearly even go beyond the geography of the historic core for city planning purposes. I don't know if illegal is the right word, but clearly it goes beyond the reason why the bid is supposed to exist, to the end that, you know, I don't know if the focus is on Jose Huizar is turning his back, or he's allowing certain things to happen, or, you know, there needs to be lawyers involved, or the media needs to be paying more attention to this, but it's clear that power and authority is being abused.
I think so. All right, I don't want to keep you here indefinitely. It's 8:30. Let me just talk for like 10 minutes more maybe about the Skid Row Neighborhood Council. I think that's why I'm here in the first place. Sorry, I'm just trying to remember. I hope it's